Penguins Live is presented by Spartan Stores. For locations, visit turntospartan.com.
And the Tampa Bay Lightning won all five games they played this season against Montreal. They went 5-0 against the Canadiens. And they're going to meet them starting Friday night in Montreal.
Final horn signals the end. Thanks for being with us following Game 7. Appreciate you sticking around. The series is over. With it comes to an end. The season comes to an end for the Red Wings. Tampa Bay moving on to face the Canadiens in the conference semifinals. The Wings, of course, heading home with Darren Elliott and Chris Osgood. I'm Mickey York. 2-0 in final. Guys, you can talk about how well the Wings played throughout the night, and they did, but really all that matters in a Game 7 is finding a way to win, and the Wings couldn't quite do that.
No, they played the right way. They played the way they wanted to. They came in and gave themselves a chance to win. But when they had the opportunity, especially in the second period where they created so many chances, they couldn't get the lead, and ultimately it cost them.
Without full marks for effort, obviously this is one of the better games they've played in the series besides Game 5, like I said before, but really came down in the second period, like Darren said. They had multiple chances to score on Bishop, and give him credit, he had his best game of the series tonight. When there's many questions about him letting in soft goals every single game of the series, he came to play tonight and was solid and used his size, his advantage. He made a huge save off Zetterberg in the third period, probably the only chance the Red Wings did have, but the two chances they missed late in the second period, the Tatar chance and the Helm chance, could have went a long way if one of them would have got a goal there.
Wings couldn't capitalize on their chances that the Lightning did. Braden Coburn scores the game-winning goal in Game 7. And it was a play, guys. It really started innocently enough.
Again, this is the kind of hockey that the playoff hockey is all about. It was just a chip in by Stamkos, a good two-man forecheck. And they created the lane. You can see the collapse around the net. There's the lane, and there is really an off-speed shot. It looked like Coburn towed that shot, and that's what fooled Peter Mrazek.
And that's the Callahan that they got from the Rangers, they expected. Yeah. This guy's in the trench player. He had a great game tonight as well, and he's a leader, captain of the Rangers. And he got in the trenches, dug that puck out, eyes head up, made a nice pass to Coburn, and it's just a seeing eye shot, really. And maybe Miller came down a bit. Miller had a great game tonight, yeah. But you got to protect those, and that's exactly what his thinking was, to come down and make sure Callahan didn't walk that, got his head up, made a nice play.
Chris, prior to that, as you guys mentioned, the Wings had the better of the chances, and it had been dominating on shots on goal. You always kind of woulda, coulda, shoulda in moments and games like this. The Wings certainly had their share, especially back in that second period.
Yeah, they sure did. And like I said, give Big Ben Bishop some credit. He really looked solid. His side-to-side movement was impeccable tonight. He was way better with rebounds, unlike he was in previous games. But this guy is a huge goalie. He wasn't playing huge for the first six games. Tonight, he showed up to play, and this is the guy that Coach Cooper has been raving about all season long, and we saw him tonight here, Darren.
That was the best chance in the third period that you just saw. The second period, he really held them in there where the chances were 10-1. I thought that Ben Bishop was the difference in this hockey game. And as Ozzie said, he hadn't really shown the form. And let's be honest, he's shown it in the regular season for the past two seasons. So it's not a fluke. First playoff series of the NHL for him, and he proved his mettle in Game 7.
Yeah, picked a good time to come up with his first postseason shutout. Of course, Game 7 doesn't happen for the Wings if not for the play of Peter Mrazek throughout this series. Two shutouts, just the one goal allowed in Game 7. I'm not sure if you could have asked for much more from him in his first NHL playoff.
No, especially since he's your third goalie, right? That's where the depth chart started this season. He wasn't even supposed to be on the radar. Should have been playing in Grand Rapids tonight. But instead, Peter Mrazek's season, he's done everything asked of him. We'll be disappointed as a team that they lost, but realistically, you couldn't have asked for much more from Peter Mrazek in this series or in this season.
And he continues his rise of being an excellent goaltender and becoming one of the elite goalies in the world. He's ahead of schedule probably by 2 years. I mean, this is incredible what he's done this year again. He's just a gamer. You could see out there, he just plays the game of hockey, and he loves playing. You can see in him, he gives his team a lot of excitement, and he played a great, great series. Too bad he lost. But wow, what a series by young Mrazek.
Not to put the cart in front of the horse, but is there any question that he's your number one goaltender going into next season?
I'm sure they'll have their meetings at the end of the year like they do all the time with all the players. And then individually they have them. Then they'll have meetings with the players and the coaching staff. And they'll get together with Ken Holland. And they'll make decisions, but they're not going to make anything right away here. They're going to take some time. And when the draft happens, we'll see what happens. But a lot of games, you got to have two guys now.
Right. The other thing is, a lot of times what happens with a young goaltender, you come in and you do that and you think that you've arrived, and the work isn't put in, or you come off mentally just a little bit, you're not as excited to be there, you've already done it once, and there's a little bit of a dip in your development. I'm not saying that's going to happen to Peter Mrazek, but that's why, as I said, you can't be too rash in just saying he's our number one guy. You've got to really work through it.
And don't underestimate the veteran presence of Jimmy Howard with Peter Mrazek.
Correct.
I mean, you don't want him on an island next year either. I mean, Mrazek's a great player. He's still 23 years old.
Right.
Jimmy Howard's a veteran. You've got yourself a very good tandem, possibly one of the best ones in the National Hockey League. Now, do you want to split that up? Those are the decisions that are going to have to be made moving forward.
Big decisions.
Oh, I'm not going to make that decision.
No, plenty of questions to be answered.
Tough
and
one.
The questions are beginning to be asked in the Red Wings dressing room. They've opened up the doors down in Tampa. The captain meeting with the media as we take you inside the Wings room.
Henrik, when you look back at the series, is it all about tonight, or do you think about opportunities lost in a couple of your home games?
Right now, after the game, it's tough to really, you know, talk about anything but this game. You know, I think we fought hard. One of our best games, I think, today. But we couldn't find a way to get the puck in today. And, you know, they scored in third there. And I think before that, we had a lot of good chances.
How good was Bishop tonight,
just
the saves he made against you guys?
He was good. You know, he played well. You know, I think he played well all the whole series. So did our goalie. And two good teams going at it. You know, I said that before. You know, went through seven games, and, you know, unfortunately, we couldn't get it done tonight.
Do you feel you missed the defensemen that were out of the game tonight?
You know, I think both Kindle and Marchenko played really good. You know, Kindle comes in and you know, probably is our best defenseman here tonight. Makes a lot of good plays, plays a lot of minutes, and it's impressive to see when you're been out of the lineup for a long time.
What about the play of Peter throughout the series?
Yeah, outstanding. Gave us a chance to win every night, and did the same thing here too today. Made some key saves, and you know, we didn't have a lot of shots, but those are the games that are tough for a goalie when you don't really have a chance, a lot of shots against you. But when you get them, it's a dangerous one. And but he was good.
You got a shot.
Disappointing. Is it to stand again? Talking about a first round loss.
Yeah, it is. It's really tiring. You know, obviously this year, you know, we had a good team. We had a good chance. But unfortunately, we couldn't get it done. You know, I can only look to myself. Couldn't really produce the way I wanted this postseason. No goals. Which the amount of minutes I play, I should be able to score more goals than I did.
Did you feel going into the series like much more hopeful than last year, just because you had health and depth and compared to last year?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we felt good going into the postseason here. You know, we had a little tough stretch there. We've been talking about this after West Coast trip, but we find a way to battle through in the end and got into the postseason again. You know, we felt good. Obviously, we play a good team. But I think we could have won this series as well. You know, we were in all the games but the first two, but we stole the first one. You know, I don't know really what more to say, but it's probably have more answers when we meet at Joe in a couple of days.
Henrik Zetterberg brought it up, so we won't have to mention he didn't score any goals in this series, just the three assists. A lot of people want to point the finger at him for the reason why the Wings aren't moving on to the conference semifinals. How much of the blame should he shoulder?
His fair share. I mean, he's hypercritical of himself. He's the leader. He's the captain. He expects more of himself. They need more from him from a production standpoint. I like how he tied it to the minutes. When you play over 20 minutes a game, you're out there an awful lot. Now, don't get me wrong. He's out there in a defensive role a lot of this series as well. But you do need to fit the puck in the back of the net if the Detroit Red Wings are going to create offense. And he knows that, and I think everybody else does as well.
Absolutely. To me, there's not more of a stand-up guy or a better leader in the National Hockey League, a guy that answers questions better after games. And this guy's off the charts in the leadership category. And, yeah, he had a tough series production-wise. Didn't have any goals. But I'm just going up and down the Red Wings roster for tonight's game. And there was max effort from each and every one of those players. They laid it all on the line in this game here tonight. And with a few bounces, if they would have got that C&I goal like we talked about first, they would have had this game tonight. It just happened to be Tampa Bay got it, but what an effort by the Wings. And Zetterberg, to me, he gave it his all there.
Yeah.
Just couldn't find a way to score on Bishop.
Yeah, the matchup between the captains turns out to be a wash in this series.
It does. I certainly like Henrik Zetterberg's game a lot more than Steven Stamkos. The reason being, Stamkos is just a young player. He's still maturing, and Henrik Zetterberg has gone through these wars before, so he's a very mature player. Stamkos will learn from this.
Yeah, Stamkos' game is not north-south yet like Zetterberg's is. There's quite a few stick checks and flybys. Zetterberg plays hard minutes. He uses his body. He shields the puck. He gets in there. He's in the corners. He puts in some difficult, tough minutes. And Zetterberg, to me, he had max effort each and every game of the series. Was just unable to score. And I mean, when you play a lot of playoff games over a lot of years like he has, this is going to happen at sometimes, and just happened this season.
Always much to discuss following a Game 7. We will get into all of it here over the next hour. But up next, we'll look back at all the series deciding highlights. We'll hear from Mike Babcock after what maybe was his final game as a Red Wings head coach. And, of course, we'll hear from the players as well. Trevor Thompson gathering all the post-game reaction from the dressing room when we come back. Tonight's high-speed highlights brought to you by Xfinity. Mike Babcock celebrating a birthday. Of course, you know what he wanted as a present. Pick this one up about 8 minutes in. Good chance here for the Wings. Jakob Kindle moving the puck well, guys. What a game he had tonight.
Absolutely good for him. He jumped in the lineup. He was stellar all night long. Great first passes.
And then Tampa Bay comes back on the power play, but Riley Shane is able to get there to shovel the puck out of their own end, and we remain scoreless after one period of play. Let's go to the second now. A loose puck goes bouncing into the Tampa zone. Ben Bishop on an adventure. Oh, Drew Miller that close to getting the Wings on the board. A great chance goes just wide. Now the Wings come back on the power play, pressuring the Lightning again. Zetterberg with a nice pass to Nyquist. Bishop, though, able to get a piece of it. Red Wings continue to jump on the puck. They would eventually get it back to Brendan Smith. He able to unload from the point, but Bishop able to hold on to it to stop the play. And again, we're looking for our first goal of the game. Perhaps the best chance, though, comes for the Wings right here in the second. A two-on-one, but the puck pops off of Tatar and goes by the boards. And then seconds, with just seconds left in the period, it's Datsyuk to Darren Helm with a chance. That goes just wide. Still tied at zeros after two. In the third, though, here come the Lightning. Some great passing for the Lightning to Stamkos, but Mrazek, oh, how good was this, Oz?
Outstanding. He did this all series long, frustrating Stamkos. What a save by Mrazek.
And a couple of minutes later, the puck behind the Red Wings net. Ryan Callahan gets possession, kicks it out to Braden Coburn. A knuckleballer beats Mrazek for the first goal of the game. And this would be the one last great chance for the Wings. Zetterberg, but Bishop able to slide over in time to shut the door. And then when Mrazek pulled Anton Strahlman, they were to send this thing just about the length of the ice into the empty nets, and that did it. 2-0 the final. Tampa Bay takes the series in 7 games, 4-3. We look at tonight's game summary brought to you by Motor City Casino and Hotel. But Ozzie, as you said, you look up and down the score sheet tonight, and you had guys giving all their all in order to try to pull off the victory here in Tampa Bay.
Yeah, they most certainly did. Just look at the shots on goal. Last 20 minutes, Tampa Bay only had 5 shots on net. That defense played great for the Red Wings tonight.
Team effort. I mean, the forwards were excellent coming back and collapsing. And you have to give Tampa credit. They hung in there because of their goaltender and made good on their one chance.
All right, more from Tampa Bay still to come, including Mike Babcock's post-game press conference. We'll also head back in the dressing room next to hear from the aforementioned Peter Mrazek. That and more when Red Wings Live continues. Playing their 5th straight Game 7 on the road tonight in Tampa. They're now 2-3 in those situations, but it's tough to fault the Wings rookie netminder. Stopped 15 shots tonight, but Braden Coburn's was the lone shot that slipped by. Still a heck of a playoff debut for the rookie, and Trevor Thompson is with him for this postgame interview brought to you by Menards. Save big money on all your home improvement needs at Menards.
Peter, when you reflect back on the series as a whole and your play and how instrumental you were in even getting this team to a Game 7, you've got to feel pretty good about yourself and your teammates here tonight.
Yeah, you know, it's about a team, and we lost the Game 7, so that's what we should talk about.
You outshot them pretty heavily, and it seemed like the game was played more of the style that you wanted to play here. Do you think the team overall, although you didn't get the result you wanted, executed the game plan that you were looking for here?
You know, we came hard. First 10 minutes, we try play offense. You know, we try throw the puck to the net and get some rebounds. And, you know, we just couldn't get any bounce to the net. And, you know, just one goal different make the series over for us.
As far as the play of your teammates go here tonight, everybody came hard, as you said, but what do you think the difference was in the end?
You know, just the one goal. That was the most different. You know, we had some chances. We couldn't score any, we didn't have any bounces that went in. And, you know, when I said that they scored one goal, we didn't.
Is now a time where you can reflect on maybe some things that you might have learned and how good this experience was for you as far as moving on in your career and just having this opportunity here?
It was a great opportunity, and I think it's going to help me in for the future. Great experience, and we have to look forward for next season right now.
Do you think you guys maybe put yourself in a position to maybe ask too much of yourselves to have to win three games on the road in this building against the team that had the best home record in the league this year?
No, I wouldn't say it's different if you're playing home on the road in NHL right now. The teams are similar, you know, playing hard every game, and sometimes you win on the road, sometimes you don't, and we didn't today.
Can you just explain the goal that was scored? What you saw?
You know, I didn't see the puck coming. DK tried block it, and I think the guy faked it a little bit, and DK didn't, and I didn't see it, and it went through me.
Were you just going to the left trying to get a view of it?
Well, you know, I knew he's going to shoot one timer there, and I lost it when DK went down. But it was a nice shot. I always said maybe he faked it a little bit, but he hit that very well.
You know, obviously with the two big defensive guys out tonight, how well did Kindle and Marchenko play for you guys?
They play great. You know, we didn't give them much chances, many shots, but we did the games before, and so they did really, really good job for us.
Particularly with Kindle, how impressive is that to see him be out for so long from the lineup and be able to come in and contribute like he did, especially in such a do or die situation?
You know, it's hard for players when you don't play for a while, and then you're going for a playoff game. But I'm sure he was working hard, practicing hard, and that made him easier.
Peter, what do you take away from your first Stanley Cup playoffs experience?
Good experience, and big disappointing right now, but I hope it's going to help me for the future.
Can't say enough about the play of that kid in this series. He is tonight's Fox Sports Detroit Red Wings Player of the Game. Is resisted by the $2 for $5 question, quarter pounder with cheese. You look at the 15 saves tonight, a .925 save percentage in this series, and a .211 goals against. Pretty good stuff from a guy that's only going to get better. All right, up next, we'll bring you more from the Red Wings dressing room as a player reaction to the Wings Game 7 loss continues to come in. But when we return, Mike Babcock will join Trevor Thompson one-on-one to discuss the series end and perhaps what's next for him and the Wings. Mike Babcock celebrated his 52nd birthday today, hoping, of course, to blow out the candles on this series with a win. A win that would have been his 83rd of the postseason, the most of any NHL coach since 2003. He'll have to settle for the start of his summer vacation, and maybe the possibility that he has coached his last game of the Wings. Babcock starting to answer those questions as we send it back to Trevor Thompson in Tampa.
Mickey, it was a lot to ask for the Red Wings to come into Tampa Bay and win three games to take this series. And in the end, the Lightning do prevail. But, Mike, you gave them all they wanted here tonight. When you look back, what was the biggest difference in your mind?
Well, I mean, let's be honest. We were better than they were tonight. And we had the puck all the time, and we didn't score. And they got a break, and they scored a goal. We had lots of opportunity. And, you know, if you compare game one to this, our team got better and better and better. And in the end, they had the puck all the time in game one. They didn't have it tonight. So you got to be proud of our guys and the way they dug in and worked. And yet in saying that, we're going home early. And so, there was 9 teams going into tonight's game. There's only 8 teams now. And, I mean, we did lots of good things in the end. But, we were looking forward to going to Montreal. And so it's disappointing without any question. We thought we had done enough good things in this series to advance, but it gives you a bit of an empty feeling.
You talk about having opportunities here tonight. You also had opportunities in Game 4 and Game 6 at home. Do you think much about opportunity lost in this series, or does it all come down to tonight for you?
Well, the way I look at it is I thought our team played well, and I thought we got better as the series went on. And you don't control everything. You just work it. I mean, today it looked like they went to church and we didn't. And, you know, I mean, the bottom line is I thought we came in here and we were prepared and we executed and should have found a way to win. We didn't. But the team that loses often feels like that.
Henrik Zetterberg thought that said that Kindle might have been your best defenseman tonight. You had two guys filling in. Your thoughts on the way that Marchenko and Kindle played for you here?
Well, I was like him. I thought Kindle played as good a game as maybe he's ever played for us, both offensively and defensively. I thought he was a real factor in the game.
And what about Mrazek throughout the entire series? We saw him grow up a lot. Your thoughts on the effort he gave you?
Well, he gave us a chance. That's all you can ask for. And, you know, he's a young goalie that's going to get better, obviously. And, you know, we'll be part of the future here with the Wings.
A lot of times it's this time of year we find out what injuries guys are playing with. Can you share what some of your guys are sacrificing throughout this series?
No, what we'll do is we'll have a year-end meeting and then we'll talk to the press like we always do.
All right, Mike, thanks for this.
Thank you.
That's Mike Babcock here as we wrap things up in Tampa. Mickey, back to the studio to you.
All right, Trevor, thank you. Certainly there's much speculation about what the future holds for Mike Babcock going forward. Do we see him behind the Red Wings bench for the foreseeable future?
I don't think so. And I mean, I think he hasn't signed all year the contract. And they've talked a few times, but not a heck of a lot of times with Ken Holland. I just feel like he's ready to move on. And he's earned it. He's had a great run here for 10 years. And that's just my gut feeling right now. He's going to get a ton of offers. There's a lot of teams that are going to try and court him, probably by tonight or tomorrow for sure. And he's 52 now, and he might want to go in a different direction. And he's earned the right to make that decision.
Well, the other thing is that Toronto Maple Leafs media are already up the 401 to try to meet the plane in Detroit to talk to Mike Babcock. That's how some of these markets are going to court him. I think, I mean, maybe I'm reading too much into it when he says, you know, talking about Peter Mrazek, the end of that soundbite when he says, here with the Wings, not here with us. You know, sometimes there's some subtlety in the language, subtlety in the way he's approached things down the stretch that tell me that if he's not leaving, he's certainly going to listen to everybody out there.
Certainly seems like he's been rumored to be involved with a lot of different teams, and not many of them are mentioned as the Red Wings. So we'll see, I'm sure, in the next couple of days or weeks. Up next, though, we will be joined by Ken Daniels and Mickey Rebin. They have been through it all with the Wings this season. They'll share their Game 7 thoughts when we come back. Red Wings Live is brought to you by Spartan Stores. For locations, visit turnsospartan.com. And by Line & Kugel's Summer Shandy. Join us out here. Well, despite the fact that Tampa Bay was the best home team during the regular season, the Wings won games 1 and 5 on Tampa Bay ice, so the task of doing it again in Game 7 didn't seem especially daunting. In fact, since the lockout, the home team was just 19-22 in Game 7s. Lightning strikes twice, but not thrice. Ken and Mick with more on the series and season finale as we send it back to Tampa Bay for the Booth Report.
So Steven Stamkos becomes the first 40-goal man in the NHL since the 09-10 season, and Alexander Semin to be blanked in a playoff series. If you had said at the start of this series, Steven Stamkos will lead the Lightning and all players in penalty minutes, have only 3 assists, do you like the Red Wings' chances? I'd say, heck yeah. And somehow...
Johnson.
It's a difference.
When you have somebody who goes cold, like Stamkos did, scoring goals, you have to have somebody pick up the slack. How often does Mike Babcock talk about, you know, contributions from other people, opportunities for other people? Well, you can give it young Johnson, 5'8", scores 6 goals, and a couple of them were absolutely huge in this series for sure. When Detroit thought they had him in Game 6, and he opens up with that lightning goal, no pun intended there. I mean, he was just their catalyst throughout pretty much the whole series. He was a non-factor in Game 7, Ken, but nonetheless, they had it from different areas. They got it when they needed it, and that's why they're going on.
A non-factor in Game 7, but earlier in the series when the Red Wings really could have wrapped this thing up, but then it got away from them, and especially the one at the Joe and Johnson getting the winner in overtime. Now, they get 2 goals from defensemen here tonight to Tampa Bay, and now we have to turn to the Red Wing defense, who I thought, without Nick Cronwall, without Marek Jedlicki, a terrific effort tonight.
They did a terrific job here tonight. The kid's coming in for sure. But as I check my notes and I look at Eric Cole, Johan Franzen, Abdelkader missing the start of the series, 41 had a hand that he probably shouldn't have been playing with. So did 43. Helm. You lose your top defenseman, 55, here because of suspension. And look at the numbers here. Brendan Smith, 22 and a half minutes. Kindle, 16 and a half. Datsyuk played 20. Zetterberg, 21. 21 minutes for Quincy. 24 minutes for DeKaiser. 19 for Erickson. Marchenko played 13. They did a great job. They didn't have all hands on deck because of injury and suspension. Peter Mrazek. I don't know what to say about Peter Mrazek. It's hard to describe what he did in this series. Shut him out twice. He had to be better with less shots tonight than Ben Bishop had to be, because Detroit was playing the muddy track kind of game. Keep it muddy, keep it ugly, try to get a good bounce, but Tampa Bay ended up getting the bounce, and that's why they won the game. But Mrazek, you said it at the end of the show, he has laid a foundation for what could be an incredible career in the NHL. What a goaltender, plays the puck, acrobatic, great attitude. Guys love him. He was unbelievable in this series, and it's a shame for him alone that this team had to lose this series in seven games. He and many other youngsters on this team, Ferraro, I thought, doing a great job coming up late in the season.
And then he got hurt late and didn't return in that one. So that was unfortunate. But certainly with what's going on in Grand Rapids and the Red Wings, the future is bright. A fun game here tonight, just not as much fun in the end at all.
All right, Ken, Mick, guys, thank you so much for everything this season. Up next, we will hit the reset button on Game 7 and take you back into the Red Wings dressing room for Trevor Thompson's one-on-one conversation with Wings defenseman Danny DeKaiser. Well, it was everything you hoped Game 7 would be, minus the final score. The Wings and Lightning were scoreless going into the third tonight, but the Lightning, with just about 4 minutes into the third, got their first of the night when Braden Coburn beat Peter Mrazek with a knuckleball of a puck. Tampa Bay Lightning would then add an empty netter to make the final 2-0 as they take the series 4-3. Welcome back to our Red Wings Live Game 7 postgame coverage. Chris Osgood, Darren Elliott, and Mickey York with you. So much concern, guys, going into Game 7 without Nick Cromwell and Marek Zielinski back on the blue line. But from Kindle to Marchenko, and overall, the Wings' defensive game is almost as stout as it was in their Game 5 shutout win in Tampa Bay.
Yeah, and we like Brendan Smith's game as well. And the forwards did an outstanding job of supporting. I thought the overall team concept was phenomenal. And Jakob Kindle, full marks. He's been an afterthought. He was tremendous. But you can see good support down low in the house, below the hash marks. Excellent play by Glendening. They get the puck out of the zone. Look at the battle on the boards. Good support there by Miller, who was strong all night long.
By far and away, this is their best defensive game in the series. Tampa only had 8 even strength shots this entire hockey game here tonight. Detroit, on the other hand, had 25. Really played great. They just couldn't find a way to score. This defense played great.
Let's be serious here. Smith was incredible. He's looking forward to next year. The coaching staff, to see him play like that, has to be impressed. Kindle was great as well. Marchenko was really solid. I thought huge minutes by DeKaiser, and he really, under the radar again, this young player plays way beyond his years, had a tremendous game for the Red Wings.
All right, speaking of that defensive effort and Danny DeKaiser, Trevor Thompson is with him one-on-one as we take you back inside the Wings room.
Mickey, thank you very much. Obviously a tough moment for Danny DeKaiser and the rest of the Red Wings. Danny, just give us your personal feelings on what took place here tonight and how you're feeling now that it's all over for you guys.
Well, I mean, it's a tough way to finish the season. You know, he worked so hard all year, and then, you know, it comes down to one game and you're not able to get it done. So, you know, you're kind of left with an empty feeling. But, you know, I'm pretty proud of how the guys played out there tonight. You know, I think we outshot them by a pretty good margin, and we just couldn't get one to go in when we really needed it. So, you know, it stings. It stings. And end of the season always, you know, always hurts.
You did outshoot them, and it seemed to be the type of game you wanted to play, a low-scoring game. You got them into your type of game here and executed the game plan you wanted. What was the difference as far as you were concerned in the end, though?
I mean, you know, they were just able to get it done. It was kind of a lot like Game 1 a little bit, where we, you know, they took the play to us pretty much the whole night, and we were able to squeak it out. But tonight, you know, it was kind of the opposite, and it was just, you know, a tight game. It wasn't much room out there, and just, you know, unfortunate that we weren't able to get the win.
That first goal, it looked like it took a funny bounce. Did it bounce off of some part of you before it went behind Mrazek?
It just, I just kind of went in front to block it, and I think he saw me in the lane a little bit. And then he kind of, I think he actually fanned on it a little bit, but it went up and into the corner. So, you know, that's worse for you. That's hockey. So, you just move on, I guess.
You know how tough it is to play defense in this league, let alone in a game seven of this magnitude, but then Kindle and Marchenko come in here tonight, hadn't played much in the series. Just talk about the effort that you got from them here tonight, taking it up for the Cromwell and for Jaliski not being in the lineup.
Well, I mean, I thought they were great. You know, step into a game seven like that at the end of a series, a high tempo, fast series like that, you got to give them a lot of credit. You know, and they're sticking with the game. You know, when they're scratched out of lineup, stuff like that. So you got to kind of tip your hat to them because they play great tonight.
When you look at some of the young guys and moving forward, you must be happy with what you see as far as the future when you have Mrazek and that some of the young guys that showed what they can do in this series as well.
Yeah. I mean, you know, some of the young guys really came through for us in the series, Mrazek especially. Tatar had a few big goals there, and guys played well, and you know, we'll take this as a learning experience and move on. That's all you can really do with it right now.
Danny, we appreciate your time. Thanks for this.
Yeah, thank you.
There's Danny DeKeyser here in Tampa. Now, Mickey, let's go back to you inside the studio.
All right, Trev, thank you. We bring you tonight's Total Impact, brought to you by Total Hockey. Ben Bishop with the honors. He was peppered by Red Wing shots throughout tonight's game, but was equal to the task. Bishop stopped all 31 shots the Wings threw at him and picks a horrible time to post his first career postseason shutout as the Wings fall 2-0 in game set. Cut it out, Bishop. Still more to come from Tampa Bay. Trevor Thompson continuing to gather post-game reaction from the dressing room, and we'll take you to Mike Babcock's post-game press conference where he will be asked about his future. His answer to that next. Welcome back to Red Wings Live. 2-0 the final from Amalie Arena in Tampa Bay. Game 7 and the series goes to the Lightning. We heard from Mike Babcock earlier in his conversation with Trevor Thompson. He's made his way to the podium now for his post-game press conference where the subject of his future in Detroit did come up.
No, we played well. I mean, the puck didn't go in and went in for them. You know, if you compare Game 1 and Game 7, I thought our team got better as the series went on. And we played good here today. And, you know, you win, you win. It doesn't, we get to game seven, doesn't matter how you win, you move on. But, you know, our team played well.
Mike, was there a missed opportunity along the way during the series, or where do you think the series
Well, I mean, there's two times, you know, you look at is it game four when they won with there, and then even tonight we had good opportunities and didn't score. And on some of our good opportunities, Tats and Helmer in particular, two of them, they didn't get a shot. You know, and give Bishop credit for being big, but they didn't get a shot on those. And saying that our team played well, we played real hard. And, you know, they dominated game one, and our goalie had to be good. I mean, we had the puck a lot tonight, to say the least. Right.
Difficult to
come back after. Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. I mean, I thought we had sure had them swirling. We gave ourselves every opportunity. We didn't score. So anyway, you look at it, that's what the game is. You got to score. And when you wake up tomorrow, they're moving on and they won 2-0. You don't bother going back and digging into how the game was played. You know, so it's disappointing for our group for sure. We thought we did a lot of good things. I mean, coming in, no one picked us to win the series. If you watch game seven here today and you watch the series, it sure didn't look like it was lopsided.
Mike, Henrik Zetterberg described it as tiring to be talking about another early playoffs exit.
I mean, you know, I never really thought about that, to be honest with you. I just, I thought our team played hard and we gave ourselves an opportunity. And when you want to win, I'm no different than him. I like winning. So in order to do that, you got to score more goals and you got to find a way to win the series. The bottom line, we're right there here, but we didn't get it done.
Hey Mike, do you feel like you guys are making the progress in New York? That's what, 3 out of 4 years, you know, first round exit. I mean, do you feel very pleased with the progress you guys are making?
Well, I would tell you this, is that our team's not as good as it was. I mean, it's very evident we battled our butt off to get in the playoffs. You know, I mean, they picked us, and whether you guys know what you're talking about or not, the sports writers pick us to miss the playoffs, and then they pick us, no one even picks us to win in the playoffs. I mean, I thought we gave that team a real good run for the money, to say the least. And so, you know, you are what you are, and they have a young team that they were bad here for long enough that they were able to rebuild it, and they got good young players, and they got young players in key positions. And, you know, some of three of our best players are 34, 35, 37. So any way you look at it, you know, we're a team that has changed a ton of players, and we're a team that's, you know, added a lot of youth to our lineup. But right now, on the outside, they don't pick us as a Stanley Cup contender.
Mike, just as far as your future, what's in the next few days for you?
Well, I'm not talking about that now. We'll talk about tonight's game. I think we'll have a team meeting and a final press conference. I'll be happy to talk about any of that crap then.
Is this a team just from the development you've seen from young players that you see going forward next year?
Yeah, I mean, we got lots of good young players, no question about it. And ideally, we got some good ones coming. But, you know, who's gonna replace Pav? You know, and I don't think Pav's going anywhere right away, but I mean, that's what you got to do. In the end, you got to have big-time players up the middle and on the back to be successful. So those are questions in our organization that we work towards. We've been drafting good and developing good, but we've been winning too much. That's the facts.
How about the Jed Mrazek game?
I thought he was great.
The entire series.
Yeah, I thought he was good. I mean, he's a young guy with good athleticism and a good mind for the game, and he's going to get better. Well, you know, I thought our team played hard and gave us an opportunity, and, you know, our fans should be proud of how hard our guys competed. They really did compete and do a good job. What it does is it, you know, I always do this at the end of every year anyway. It's going to be no different this year. Ken Hall and I will sit down. We'll look at the team like we always do. I don't think that'll be any different.
Mike Babcock there was sort of the state of the Red Wings. He will address his future again in the upcoming days. But back to the game for a moment. He did address all the Wings' missed opportunities tonight. There's no question. They have plenty of chances to score that first goal and maybe change the way this series ended up going.
That was the most opportunities they've had 5-on-5 in the entire series. I mean, more or less, they weren't getting a lot 5-on-5 for 2-3 games at a time. 28 shots, 5-on-5. They had plenty of opportunity. Give Ben Bishop credit. I sat here and said he couldn't get it done. Well, he proved me wrong here tonight. This kid played great in the Game 7 on the big stage, making 31 saves. In the second period especially, a lot of key saves. Yes, Helm missed, but Tatar missed late. That could have made a huge difference. But he played like the 6'7" frame. He was big tonight.
Early on, you can see that the Red Wings just got into their rhythm by putting anything at the net. And you can see that as it went on, that's a third period save. When he went from the first shot on goal was off his chest and an 8-foot rebound. By the end, he's reading and coming across and making a great save with the game on the line against Zetterberg. He got into his rhythm.
And every other game was the opposite. He started out good, and it seemed like he'd be just holding on near the end. Tonight, that wasn't the case whatsoever. He got better and better as that game went along.
Yeah, and the rebounds, some of which he was giving up earlier in this series, just weren't there tonight. All right, when Red Wings Live continues, we'll give you your Game 7 in a nutshell, and with the sound cranked, it's the instant replay next. Sudden death, winner takes all, do or die. It can all really be summed up in just two words. Game 7, one last joust between two battle-tested warriors that leaves one man, one team standing, and another struggling with the sudden finality of it all. We love this kind of stuff. We love that thrill of victory, and we reluctantly accept the agony of defeat. Tonight's Game 7 instant replay takes us through the highs, the lows, and the handshakes.
This the fourth consecutive year and just the sixth time the past 24 years in this remarkable playoff run. The Red Wings did not start the playoffs with home ice advantage. Mike Babcock, his 52nd birthday today. You know he'd love nothing more than a victory in this one. On defense along with Alexei Marchenko. Hindo with a good feed into Yurko with a step, and he's in right into the belly. A Bishop who hangs on. Back to the line here. He's got it now. Stamkos didn't shoot it. Nesterov played it. Shot. Mrazek save. Rebound in front of the goal. What a check by Sheahan. Creates another issue. But the Red Wings do clear it. Look at this. And a break for the puck. Miller. Bishop coming out. Miller chipped it. Oh, and just wide. Over here on the wing for help. Tatar to the goal. There it is. Right in the goal. Oh, here comes Tatar. 5 seconds left in the period. Tadatsu, quick pass back. Coming in. Oh, and he missed the net. periods in the books, and in the last 2 minutes, the Red Wings had two glorious opportunities to get on the board, but couldn't do it. Circling in front. Oh, a save.
What a stop that was.
Best of the game here by Peter Mrazek. Back is Quincy. Hit by Killorn. Puck came free. Over and open. There's a shot. Scores!
Well, they get possession in behind right here. Three white jerseys, only two blue, and it's Callahan that makes the play. You got two blues on Quincy right away, and they get possession before Detroit can get there. No, this didn't hit anybody. It was a bit of a knuckleball, and Coburn, who had eight shots in game one here, gets the first goal of the game.
DeKeyser, ahead for Ablocator. Good play. Back for Nyquist. He's right in. Zetterberg, and a save by Bishop. Didn't get enough on it. 1.5 to go in the third. Red Wings in the midst of a change. Close to too many men, but not. Mrazek on the bench for an extra skater. Red Wing net is empty. Sold out crowd standing here in Tampa Bay. This going to the empty net. The score! And the Tampa Bay Lightning won all five games they played this season against Montreal. They went 5-0 against the Canadiens. And they're going to meet them starting Friday night in Montreal.
And that's it. So up next, final thoughts on this Red Wings season and perhaps a brief look ahead. We'll be right back. Clock is winding down here on Red Wings Live. It does not end, of course, the way we wanted it to. Questions will be answered in the days to come, but when you've lost in the first round for the last 5 years, you can expect some changes too.
Yeah, I think moving forward, they'll have their meetings with Ken Holland and the scouting staff and the management, and they'll figure out what direction they want to go in with certain players. And they do have some questions, obviously, moving into this offseason, Franz and being one of them. We don't talk about him very often. Howard and obviously Babcock, if he's going to be back or not. But I think this season, the positives far outweigh the negatives. A lot of good things moving forward for this club.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the good things depend on decisions on young players. How quickly do you get them to the big club, and how does that impact your roster moving forward?
Like the string quartet on the Titanic, gentlemen, it's been a pleasure playing with you. And thank you, Red Wings fans, the best in all of hockey, for being with us all season long here on Fox Sports Detroit. For Darren and Ozzie, thanks for watching. We'll leave you now with a final take. Fox Sports Live is up next.